Greetings and welcome back. So where we are in this particular section is we're thinking about the field theory of Toner and Tu. This will be our first introduction to a field theory in earnest, and I want to make sure that everyone's aware that this is one of those topics where we're not going to have any hope in a 20-minute vignette of getting ourselves up to speed on what is a field theory and how do we write them down and how do we solve them and understand their implications and so on. So, little by little, what we're going to do is we're going to turn this page over, and we're going to just slowly reveal the nature of a field theoretic treatment of these kinds of problems. So I want to start with the origins of this particular story. The origins, I'm sure, go back for thousands of years, where people observed the interesting behavior of herds, the murmuration of birds in Italy, and so on. But the specific modern rise of active matter theory, you could say, at least in part, can be traced to this paper from Physical Review Letters, which is now referred to as the V-check model. As you can see, the first author is Tomasz V-check. And in this paper, what they did was to examine herds on a computer screen, if you like, and more to the point, herds in two dimensions. So the idea mathematically is that they have a bunch of individual agents. And as you can see on the upper right-hand side, what I've done is I've grabbed two equations, the first two equations from this paper, which basically give us an update rule. They tell us two things. They tell us about the new position of one of these agents, and this is precisely how you would find your position if you were driving between two points, let's say between Denver and St. Louis or Los Angeles and San Francisco. You're at a given position, you want to find out where you're going to be a little while later, you take your current position, you add to that V times delta T. So that's the first equation. The second equation is what I'll refer to as democratic smoothing. We're going to come back to this in a little while, but the idea is that I am one of these agents, and I look at all of my neighbors, and I ask each of them what angle describes the direction that you're pointing. And then the notion of democracy enters, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to adjust myself, adjust the update my own angle by taking the average of all of my neighbors' angles. So in a certain sense, I'm giving everybody equal weight, that's in my neighborhood, and then I'm adjusting my angle accordingly. But then also the delta theta refers to a noise term. And what's shown at the bottom, I'm not going to go into it any further, but you're welcome to read the paper, is that they comment on what the implications are of this kind of model and how it depends on the density. You can see that if the density is sufficiently low, then there's not going to be any neighborhood that's going to suffice to encourage ordering, I guess, is the way I might want to say it. Okay, so shortly after that, there arose this paper that's shown on the left, long-range ordering in a two-dimensional dynamical X-ray model, how birds fly together. And you can see the equation there, equation one, which is essentially the equation that we're going to be working our way towards in the remainder of this vignette, and probably in another vignette, and then also in a homework. I just wanted to call your attention to, on the right-hand side, this truly fantastic paper by John Toner, which he wrote as a result of some lectures that he gave, if I remember correctly, at Les Huches in France. And the point is that this is an extremely well-written and extremely creative treatment of this whole suite of problems. And, I can't recommend it highly enough. So before embarking on my statements about the Toner 2 field theory, I want to use diffusion, and we're going to come back to this in great detail probably next week. I want to use diffusion as a sort of a warm-up to get us a sense of what we would mean by a field theory. So let's think about the little example shown on the left. There you see that there's a box. The box has a partition in it. On the left-hand side, the left-hand partitioned volume, we start with an initial condition in which all the molecules of interest are there, and then at some point we remove the barrier and ask for the subsequent time evolution of the concentration. And when I say the subsequent time evolution, what I have in mind is that I'm going to define everything I want to say about this system is contained in the field variable C of x and t. So what do I mean by that? I mean that there's a concentration at position x at time t. And what I want to find is the concentration at position x at time t plus delta t, where delta t is a little element of time, a little increment of time. What's the concept? The concept is, let's focus, as we show up here, these four little graphs. We're going to focus on the lth box. So that's this is a histogram. It tells you the number of particles at each position. We've discretized the x-axis into positions, into boxes, which are labeled by integers, L, L minus 1, L plus 1, L plus 2, L plus 3, etc., starting at box 1. And the rule is that the concentration in my box of interest now is the concentration in that box of interest a moment ago. How long ago? Delta t ago. And then what I do is I update according to the following notion. The box at L, there's a histogram. A particle could jump from the position to the right at a distance a away. So that is the concentration at x plus a. And the number that will jump into the box at x is a function of how many are sitting in the box at x plus a. Similarly, there's a box to the left at x minus a, and every particle in that box flips a coin, and if it gets a heads, it moves into the box at x. So the x plus a and x minus a correspond to my neighbors, particles in my neighboring boxes jumping into the box of interest. The minus 2cx of t is the fact that particles in the box of interest have jumped either to the right or to the left. So in a way, this is all there is to it. This is a discrete representation of the field theory of diffusion. I just playfully note, you know, I think I mentioned in the last vignette that I think it's goofy and kind of funny that Galileo made this remark about the universe is described by a language whose characters are triangles. And I think there's just a strange irony to the fact that one of the most important symbols that we use in mathematical physics is an upside down triangle. Very consonant with what Galileo had to say on the matter. So again, just to be clear, the field theory idea is that there's a field variable or field variables that describe our system in some way or another. And then there's an update rule. And this update rule can be translated mathematically into what later we'll see as a partial differential equation. But for the moment, if I were to get on a computer, I would have a series of discrete boxes, and the students in the class will indeed do this. They'll do exactly this kind of problem. And the update is that at every instant we change our statement of how many particles are in each of the boxes based on the rule shown on the right, which really amounts to coin flipping, as you'll see when we go into this more deeply later. Now we can use this field theory idea in order to update the concentrations. So what you see is the initial condition in blue in the graph at the bottom, and then the red curve is a little bit later, the yellow curve is 10 times later than that, the purple curve is 5 times beyond that, and then finally the green curve shows the final saturation or the steady state value where the concentration is now uniformly distributed across the whole box. And this corresponds to what you would have expected intuitively, right? You would have expected that I started out with half space full at some concentration C, or C naught, let's call it. And now what I would imagine is that after the system equilibrates, that I would have a uniform distribution of concentration at concentration C naught over 2. So that's the concept. So that's the field theory idea in a nutshell. So now what I want to do is I want to, you know, examine a modern example, which is field theories of Hertz, and note that this kind of thinking can be applied across a billion-fold range in length scales, all the way from wildebeest, which, you know, it's the kilometers length scale, to the ordering of filaments at the microns scale inside of a cell. So what are the field variables? What fields do we need to keep track of in order to describe the behavior of these wildebeest? Well, we're going to invoke the wildebeest density, that is, how many wildebeest are there per unit area, and we will use the wildebeest velocity. And, you know, this should conjure up in your minds some sort of an idea that's similar to what you would think about when you were thinking about water and the flow of water or the breaking of waves or whatever. There, you're going to keep track of the density and you're going to keep track of the velocity field. So let's get into the mind of the wildebeest and see how some of the different terms that arise in the so-called Toner 2 theory do in fact arise. So if I'm the wildebeest labeled 2, so I have a velocity v2, the concept here for the one-dimensional wildebeest organization is I'm going to check in with my neighbors. I'm going to look to behind me at the wildebeest behind me, which is traveling at speed v1, and I'm going to take the difference between our two velocities, and you can see that that difference actually is pointing to the left. I look ahead to wildebeest number 3, and I take the difference between its velocity and my velocity, and that gives me a difference v3 minus v2, and that's pointing to the right. Then the concept, a la V-check, what I showed you a little while ago, is that we'll democratically average. We will take the average of these differences. The idea being that I want to do the best to try to satisfy all my neighbors. And what you see is that, you know, the term in brackets in the bottom under which we have labeled second derivative of velocity in space, what do you see? You see V1 plus V3 minus 2V2. I just, you know, ask you to note that that's the same as this rule. C of three plus C of one minus two C of two, if I were to use the same language. Okay, so what we learn is that there's a term here, which is a smoothing term or a democratic smoothing, where a wildebeest checks in with its neighbors. I'm going to go into this in more detail in the final vignette about herding, and then the students will have a chance to think about it in the context of a homework. But what I'm showing you here is a minimal version of the Toner 2 model. When I say minimal, what I mean by that is there are more terms that are allowed by symmetry. And said differently, I can invoke more terms that involve two powers of velocity and one power of derivatives. I can invoke more terms that involve one power of velocity and two powers of derivatives. And those will be above and beyond what I show you at the top. But this minimal set kind of highlights the key concepts that I would want to communicate to you. So we've already talked about the smoothing term. Let's talk about the preferred speed term. The thing that you see there is that there's some speed at which the wildebeest would prefer to be traveling. You might think of that as something like your natural walking pace. And you know, there might be some wildebeest that decides to trot, or maybe got interested in something on the ground and looks aside and slows down. And this term in the equations says, hey, if you sped up, you need to slow down and get back in lockstep with the rest of the herd. If you've slowed down too much, you need to speed up to catch back up to the velocity of your neighbors or your friends. So that preferred speed is really a one-body term. It doesn't really have to do with consulting the neighbors, it just has to do with saying that there's a characteristic speed. The pressure term, which is represented by a gradient in density, what I want you to imagine here is let's start off with a two-dimensional box of uniform density. What this thing is saying is that it's going to punish any situation that tends to bunch the wildebeest up with sort of a variation, because if I take this uniform density and I squish them into one side, it's going to punish the fact that I've now introduced a gradient. So this is going to tend to keep the density uniform, is what I would say. We've already talked about the democratic smoothing term, and then there's this term that I'm labeling advection, and that term is really the way I think of it. One way to think of it is that I'm going to consult the neighbor in front of me. I'm going to evaluate the gradient between us. And then I'm going to punish that gradient proportionally to how fast we're going. In other words, the faster we're going, the more hostile or the more aggressive the correction will be, given that there's a gradient. So now what I wanted to do is to just simply show you a couple of calculations that Christina Heeshan and I made using the finite element method. Some of you might remember the movie The Lion King, in which Simba is chased into a gorge and there's a stampede of wildebeest. And what's shown here is an initial random distribution of wildebeest. And what you see in the long time limit is that the distribution, that's at the top, the density becomes uniform. And what you see on the bottom is that there's all the wildebeest are traveling at the same preferred speed, which in this case is 1, except those right by the edges where there's a so-called no slip boundary condition, which means that the velocity has to be 0 on the two edges. We can ask whether that's a smart picture, but what I mean by that is, like, does that correspond to biological reality of wildebeest in a gorge? And the answer to that is that I don't quite know what boundary conditions one might want to use. I just wanted to remind you of this video, which we looked at earlier, because I think it's so interesting to look at what happens when these sheep pass through an orifice. They pass through a hole in the gate. And you can see at the bottom also there's more action because there's three dogs that have run in from the bottom, and you know they're intimidating, clearly intimidating the sheep. And so to that end, we thought about what happens in the presence of obstacles. And what you see that's kind of interesting here is that there's this blob of wildebeest that get reflected off in the bottom case, that get reflected off of the obstacle, because the velocity selection term tends to want to keep everybody moving at that preferred speed. And in this case, because of the obstacle, they can't maintain their density and get through there. And so there's two choices: either they have to speed up, or alternatively, they have to turn back. So this is the main things that I wanted to say by way of introduction with respect to this Toner 2 theory, and we'll say more about